This is the Flyers Player Profile. I go through each one of the Flyers, who they are, where they come from, where they're going. Matt Niskanen is one of those players that you really hope that you can find at the twilight of their career. The Philadelphia Flyers got incredibly lucky, in my opinion, that Washington was even looking to move a player of his caliber. This is the opportunities you look for, players who get caught in maybe some cap trouble, and the team that owns them is kind of trying to find a way out of their contract, even though they're high-value players. And a team like the Capitals, who were just coming off a Stanley Cup victory, they kind of realized that, you know, they either had to move out a big contract or they might have to lose some potential young players. The Flyers might be in a similar situation in the future. If they play their cards right, they'll lose minimal amount of players, but this happens to everyone. And Chuck Fletcher made a beautiful move that allowed him to take advantage of a very advantageous situation. Philadelphia Flyers were without any true veteran top defender for quite a while, since Mark Streit, who played the end of his career here. We had Kimmo Tiiminen. These are guys who played from their mid to late 30s that were heavily relied upon to play against the best players in the world, and also to play with younger players and help bring them into their maturity age of acceleration in the NHL, and the ability to take some weight off of them, not just physically, but mentally as well. Have them answer some questions, have them know what to say, to put somebody like Ivan Provorov, Travis Sanheim, or even Shane Gostisbehere in that position such early points in their career is really not fair. And the Philadelphia Flyers made a beautiful decision to bring Matt Niskanen in. And from day one of this trade, I was thoroughly excited. Anybody who told you otherwise, that they were struggling or they were confused about him because he had a down year, I can empathize, but I didn't buy it to begin with, and I would question whether they actually watched Matt Niskanen enough in his career, because if you're just going off of statistics, you're not going to see a defenseman that lights the world on fire. But as you can see, he was highly effective in his role. And we can go back through his career, and I'll start pretty early on, just coming into the NHL. You know, if you go into the early parts of his career, primarily what you have is a defenseman who has never really excelled in the offensive game to the tier of a true number two or number one defenseman in the league. However, he's had these points, these pinnacle points in his career where he's been able to hit that level, and he's been able to play with some of the best players in the world, and complement them beautifully. I love what Chuck Fletcher said about him. He is a zero maintenance player. He could say the same thing about Ivan Provorov. In that case, you mean he is a player who will come in, do exactly what he needs to do, not complain, and give it his all every single time. While that sounds like, oh, a no-brainer, the reality is people are human. They get distracted, they get disheartened, they go through struggles, and if you're a type of player who knows how to excel in those situations, that is highly valuable to a general manager. And bringing in a player like that, you know, it was highly useful. So I'll go back and then I'll get to the trade where he kind of ended up here. But let's start where he started. I mean, we can go back to college, his college career. I mean, he had a pretty good college career, University of Minnesota Duluth. By the end of it, again, his first season in NCAA, one goal, 13 assists, minus 10. You know, you're not looking at those numbers and going, hey, this guy's going to be a top pairing defender in the NHL, right? And this is something to keep in mind here when you watch defensemen develop. You're not going to see the same staggering numbers for every defenseman across the league. It's just not true. And if you could actually look at the second and third round picks for a lot of NHL teams, a lot of those guys end up being the best defenseman in the league. Maybe not the number one, but they're the guys who fill out that 2, 3, 4, 5 spot in the NHL, because maybe they have something wrong with their game, but there's a lot of great things they bring. And I would say Matt Niskanen is definitely one of those people. So you look at a second year in the NCAA, 9 goals, 22 assists, 31 points, a minus 16. Minus 16, obviously not great, but again, NCAA level, he's not that old at the time. You got to figure he's about 20 years old at the time, right? Maybe 21, but realistically, he's probably about 20 by the time he finished NCAA. 9 goals, 22 assists, and 39 games in NCAA is very impressive, in my opinion. So you see that and you go, okay, this guy's got numbers, right? First year, not so much, but that makes a huge huge jump. So then from there, Dallas brings him into the NHL, right? They have him play for Iowa, and really, what, 13 games he plays for Iowa, 3 assists minus 4. Again, think about perspective today with the players that are in the Flyers system, and if you see a guy struggle at any point and how you can just dismiss them for being flawed of some sort or just never really going to give you what you want. I question anybody who says that ever, and I don't care. I don't care if you tell me they're 22, 24, 25, irrelevant to me. I don't think you pay attention enough to history if that's really the case. I can go through tons of players who have a similar background to Matt Niskanen, and I would argue more players fluctuate in their career than have some kind of skyrocket, entry into the league. You know, look at Shane Gostisbehere, right? There's a great example of a guy who skyrocketed, stagnated, probably goes back down, and he will go back up. I promise you that. Just because he's 27 doesn't mean he's done by any stretch of the imagination. So let's get to the next part. So he's playing with Iowa. Dallas calls him up. His first year in Dallas, I mean, this is pretty impressive. He had 7 goals, 19 assists, plus 22. I mean, at that point, you're pretty much looking at him, okay, this might be the backbone of R&D. Right? And you got to figure a team like Dallas at the time, which they weren't a great team at the time, but they were good. They were competitive, right? Similar to how the Flyers were kind of leading up, right? They didn't have everything they needed, but they had enough good defensemen. They had some names on that team that could balance them out. And Matt Niskanen was heavily relied upon at the time. The following year, again, 6 goals, 29 assists in 80 games, a minus 11 this year, right? At this point, he's still pretty young. He goes and plays in the World Championships as well. 1 goal, 2 assists in 9 games. Again, none of these numbers are kind of flying out as being like, this guy is a superstar, right? The following year, this is 2009-2010, 74 games, 3 goals, 12 assists in 74 games, right? Minus 15. Seem characteristic to you for a player who started that way? All of a sudden, you start questioning, is Matt Niskanen really what you thought he was? The following year, 0 goals, 6 assists, and 45 games for Dallas. At that point, now you're starting to worry, right? Oh, wow, he was doing really well. Now he's regressing, right? And we blame the player immediately. Blame the player. Not the situation, the player. Pittsburgh, who is a team we all love, who always seems to bring out the best in their athletes, and I would ask people to ask themselves why. Not to be jealous, not to be upset, but ask themselves why they keep producing good players, whether you heard of them or not. So we go to the next stage. He gets traded to the Penguins. In 18 games, he's got 1 goal, 3 assists. Nothing that special, but again, a little bit better than what he was doing with Dallas. So you already start seeing a trend going in the right direction there. The following year with the Pens, 4 goals, 17 assists. All of a sudden, he's getting back up there, plus 9. Following year, 40 games with the Pens, obviously injuries involved in that one. 4 goals, 10 assists, 14 points in 40 games. And that's where you start realizing this guy's in his mid-20s, and this is kind of what I'm talking about. He's got some playoff experience. Actually, that year as well, he had 15 playoff games, so you know Pittsburgh Penguins were going far, and he was heavily relied upon. And that's where we go into the following season. And this is his breakout year. But really not. Again, this is what I talk about. It's more of a fluctuation in productivity, but the game, the defensive game is still there. He always had that physical edge. He's not a big guy, but he has the same physical edge as somebody like Ivan Provorov has, maybe even a little bit more. He's actually kind of a poor man's Provorov, if you think about it in a lot of ways. They have a lot of the same skill sets. They have the same body type. They're both low-maintenance type of players. He's just a right-hand defender, and that's why it works so well. I'd actually like to see him separate Provorov in the future and let Provorov kind of carry one of the younger defensemen, but it makes complete sense for him to be playing top-pairing defenseman. The following year, 10 goals, 36 assists, 46 points in 81 games, plus 33 for the Penguins. Boom. That is top pairing number, mid-20s, all of a sudden, huge jump in his progress. And even if you look at the following year, he never really hits that again. 4 goals, 27 assists the following year. After that, 5 goals, 27 assists in 82 games. He's healthy through all of this. 5 goals, 34 assists, right? It's your role on the team. And you know, they have Chris Letang on that team. They have other defensemen who can pot in offensive numbers. He wasn't necessarily had to be that guy, right? Then he goes to the Capitals, I'm sorry, that year after he wins the championship, that was all for the Capitals, right? So the four goals, the essentially a 31 to 39 game pace over 3 years, that's pretty good. And again, not just the numbers, it's the way he plays, who he plays against. And the Penguins won a cup, a big reason, because of him. His ability to be tenacious, his ability to nonstop stand up to the better players in the National Hockey League. Niskanen had great leadership throughout that time as well. He had very good team to play again. And then obviously with the Washington Capitals, I mean, there you go. I mean, he won a cup with the Capitals, and he had a huge role in that team, right? Throughout that, he ended up putting 7 goals, 22 assists for 29 points. Then again, the following year for the Capitals, 8 goals, 17 assists, 25 points. And again, people are saying he's struggling. Look at the statistics I just told you about. Look at throughout his whole career, and people actually said he was struggling. And I want people to pay attention to that, because I heard that a lot coming in here. And that's where we get to the trade. Let's get to this trade. And again, I am a fan of Radko Gudas. I think a lot of people were a fan of Radko Gudas. He's a good bottom pairing defender. He's a very physical defender. He doesn't have the typical size for a defensive defender, but he plays way beyond his size, right? The guy is essentially a stump. He's much stronger than most players his size, or even larger than him. And he excelled in those corners. He excelled at the dirty game, which we always appreciate. Especially here in Philadelphia. But offensively, he never really chipped in that much. And not so much that he was a burden in any sense. And he had a decent breakout pass, but he was not really pushing the play offensively. I mean, most likely, he was getting pinched inside his own end. And his job really was to hit, change the game through physicality, get that puck out of the zone simply, and, you know, compliment those around him. Kind of like a poor man's Niskanen, quite frankly. And then that trade happens, and Niskanen, obviously, he's already getting paid well at $5.75 million a year, which is very good price tag for a top three defender. In this case, I would say he was a top pairing for most of these teams at times. But really, you know, let's call him a top three. Again, pretty good salary for that guy, but Capitals are in cap trouble, right? So they have to move. So they swap with the Flyers for Gudas, who's making about $3.5 million, and the Flyers choose to eat that extra million. The reason they ate that extra million was to not add any additional assets. I saw people complain about this. Again, the Flyers were in a position they could take on cap. They are not in cap hell. You're in cap hell if you can't move the players that are causing you to be in cap hell. We are not in that position. I'm sorry. I see zero evidence of that. I see the Flyers becoming one of the best teams in the league, and most likely people will want the assets that they have. That is not surprising to me in any realm. So we move on. That trade happens. The Flyers get lucky, and look where he is today. With the Philadelphia Flyers today, he had 8 goals, 25 assists for a plus 15. Does that sound astronomically higher than what he did with the Capitals? Again, I'll repeat that. 8 goals, 17 assists with the Capitals in 80 games. Yeah, he didn't finish the whole season with us. He probably would have had a career year, typically what he did with the Penguins, but he's older in his career. I thought he was supposed to be done. I thought they're all supposed to be on the decline, right? He's 33 years old. Why is he not declining? Because it doesn't work that way. There isn't some magic number that you're going to watch these guys kind of die into the ether as they hit their 30s. I am the same age as Matt Niskanen, and most people think I'm 10 years younger than I am. It doesn't matter. It's different for each person. And again, I said this over and over again. Do not bet against athletes. Why? Because they're extreme competitors. Their age will not stop them. You saw what Yager did. You're telling me that guy is not hungry to play hockey? That is part of it. That's why he did so much work afterwards. And I promise you, Niskanen's work ethic lines up with his success. Without a doubt. It does. And honestly, I think from everything we saw this year, from his breakout passes to his ability to stop the rush, for his ability to play the power play to the penalty kill, the lack of issues that come with a player like that. Like, could you think of any point during this year where you thought, oh, Matt Niskanen wasn't bringing it? Can't name it. I honestly, I would probably go through most of those seasons and you're really not finding it. And this is why the Flyers went for this. This is exactly what they needed. I said it all year. The prior year, they needed a veteran defenseman to take that weight off of Provorov, off of Gostisbehere, off of Sanheim, off of Myers. These guys are not ready to be the adults in the room. They are. Provorov, I think, is a special player. I think he'll probably get there a lot quicker than 99% of the league. But again, they need time. They need leadership. They need players who have struggled. And again, I think Matt Niskanen was a perfect addition to this roster. And quite frankly, I do anticipate he's going to get re-signed, and he should get re-signed. I don't think he's going to get what he got before, but I would give him term. A guy like that who takes care of his body, who clearly is not showing a lot of wear and tear as he moves through his career. I mean, I would give him a multiple-year contract. You know, even three-year contract, I'd sign him through his mid to late 30s at this point, right? He's probably going to be 34 by the time he signs the contract. I'd sign him to 37. I see no issues doing that. Maybe give him $4.5 million a year if he's willing to accept it. I mean, it would be a cap save for us, but the money would be there. I think even as a bottom-pairing defender, Matt Niskanen would get his money's worth. And we see that with somebody like Justin Braun, right? Like, Justin Braun is not an excellent offensive player, but you get him in the zone, you get him to stick work. He is one of the best defensemen on the Flyers in the zone. That's why the Flyers traded second and third for him. They needed the leadership as well in that room, something we definitely lacked, and both of those guys bring in stride. And I think Matt Niskanen is the perfect guy to keep around here. I prefer that he retires as a Flyer, and I wouldn't be surprised if he does. I mean, if he's happy here, I would re-sign him. I know we have a lot of defensemen we want to keep, but I think he's kind of a pinnacle point. We're going to need veterans through all this. It's nice to have the idea that all kids will play in the lineup. It's just not a reality. Everybody keeps saying it. This is a young man's game. Show me a young team that won a Stanley Cup. Show me one. Show me one young team that's won a Stanley Cup. And I've heard everybody say this. You're not going to find it, because veteran teams win Stanley Cups. Perfection wins Stanley Cups. You don't learn perfection as a kid. I'm sorry, I'm 33. I still don't know what I'm doing in life. And imagine what it feels like to be a 19, 20, 23, 24, 25, 26-year-old. You don't know what you're doing in everything. Sometimes we get lucky and we get elite players who figure it out early. Again, like Ivan Provorov. It is not a rule for everybody. And I think Matt Niskanen is a perfect example of a fine wine player. We had Mike Knuble do that. Again, Niskanen is exactly the type of player this team needs, and I think he should it in stride. And I think if he can be here, he can help pave the way for the future of the next young elite defenseman in this league, and he can play that role that he played for the Penguins and for the Capitals and now for us, and hopefully we'll see him in another Stanley Cup run.